things I could tell you.
Oh, you don't know the half of it.
It's on America's tortured brow that Mickey Mouse has grown up a cow, and the workers have struck for fame, for Lennon's on sale again. See the mice in their million hordes, from Ibiza to the Norfolk Broads. Rule Britannia is out of bounds to my mother, my dog and clowns. But the film is a saddening bore, for I've lived it 10 times or more. It's about to be lived again as I ask you to focus on sailors fighting in the dance hall. Oh man, look at those cavemen go. It's the freakiest show.
If you or a loved one is currently suffering from eco-anxiety, hopelessness, opiate addiction, social isolation, extremist political sentiment, or an absolute hatred for what humans have revealed themselves to be in times of crisis, you may be living in 2020. Yes, it does suck that we are living through what will likely be the least popular destination for any time traveler. No, the fact that one year sucks doesn't mean that it's one randomly bad year that will peacefully depart from us as soon as 2021 rolls around. Instead, 2020 can be seen as an accumulation of proxy issues, not my problems, and everything else we were putting off from taking too seriously. After all, why live your life assuming a pandemic will happen? Who has the time to participate in civic society when you have to pay a mortgage and feed your kids? There's a reason why the ancients were a little bit more passionate in the political arena.
So, Slave, who will you be voting for?
Oh, I will be voting for the anti-slave candidate.
Bah! Another uninformed single-issue voter.
And who really wants to accept the consequences of climate change? The fact that every little action you partake in, from misplacing your recyclables with your organics to forgetting to turn off your light when you drive to work in your carbon-emitting vehicle of choice to some job tied to a system that cares about consumption up until the point that consumption leads to waste. That all of this contributes to the idea that you're a wasteful, dirty, dirty, no good, parasitic ape hell-bent on destroying the planet. And then there's everything else going on. The absolute hopelessness that has pervaded the events of the past few months lends to a mental montage of dumbfoundingly asinine Facebook posts, dystopian footage of masked protesters illuminated by the flames of a burnt down Target, and terrifying visions of whatever is to come. The question then is, what is one to do, if anything, in such times of disorder? Is ignorance bliss or a privilege? Do we accept or fight, destroy or create, live or die? In order to understand the many overlapping topics and issues necessary if one is to gather any sense of proper conduct, 2020 can be broken down into 3 main themes. And here's number 1.
Noticed that our caps have actually got little pictures of skulls on them.
I don't, so.
Hans, are we the baddies?
A recent study suggests that people who feel wealthy are more likely to think that their political beliefs and values are universally true. People of higher status are more likely to think that those who disagree with them are stupid or biased, even when their high status is the result of a random process. The researchers suggest that such findings explain why wealthier individuals tend to involve themselves more in politics to begin with. This in turn leads to the consistent representation of the interest of the wealthy in the political arena, sometimes at the expense of those less fortunate. This study on the potential source of political inequality brilliantly reflects the Cambridge professor Goran Terborn's statement that never before have the possibilities of a good world for the human species as a whole been greater. At the same time, the gap between human potential and the existing conditions of humankind in its totality has probably never been wider. This gap between what we have and what we could have naturally stokes a level of rage or resentment that in turn begs for resolution. Whatever scapegoat we pin the source of the rage on, global capitalism, political correctness, creeping fascism, minority groups.
Minority groups.
The real interest lies in the rage itself. This rage, best characterized by Walter Benjamin's Divine Violence, is a means without an end when acted on. Rioting, protests, the draining of swamps, and shootings are performed without a collective vision beyond destroying that which causes the subject pain. This part isn't new. The danger lies, however, when creeping programs offer coherent justification for violence. These are apparent in Hannah Arendt's pan-movements, widespread ideas that overarch national, political, and ethnic elements. There is a single explanation for everything, and before the single explanation, everything else falls away. Not only are these dogmas dangerous in their offering of a comfortable worldview at the sacrifice of any critical thinking, they target the Achilles heel of any pluralistic society, the tolerance of intolerance. Any liberal democracy requires some level of pluralism, some tolerance of those who hold contradictory views. The ability to listen to, at least on paper, everyone's opinion has subsequently led to the championing of democracy as the solution to almost all of our problems. Any class struggle, ethical issue, or foreign problem may cause momentary suffering, but, as the progressive and well-educated citizen of the world will suggest, yes, but we have democracy. While we preach the Athenian gospel, these pan-movements slowly encroach on such peace-loving lands of liberal democracy and swiftly cripple this very fundamental idea of tolerance. As Karl Popper famously wrote, "Unlimited tolerance must lead to the disappearance of tolerance. If we extend unlimited tolerance even to those who are intolerant, if we are not prepared to defend a tolerant society against the onslaught of the intolerant, then the tolerant will be destroyed and tolerance with them." Popper doesn't suggest that we suppress intolerance at all times, but we should reserve the right to stop them, even by force. We should therefore claim in the name of tolerance the right not to tolerate the intolerant. Why such a harsh policy? Popper suggests that like a virus, fascism can enter the bodies of democracy and exploit its toleration to the point of further spread. Would Popper's ideas still be considered democratic, especially when we consider the idea that true freedom must provide the freedom to be evil? Could we continue believing that democracy is the supreme good if it naturally allows for the supremacy of the intolerant? Is this how democracy ends? Not in its procedural form, but rather in the idea of democracy as an incorruptible hope that solves all issues. Such questions, the paradox that any tolerant society must endure, lends itself to Arendt's idea that it is quite conceivable, and even within the realm of practical political possibilities, that one fine day a highly organized and mechanized humanity will conclude quite democratically, namely by majority decision, that for humanity as a whole, it would be better to liquidate certain parts thereof.
Hey guys, sorry, but the 51 of us voted to kill the 49 of you. Oh! Well, if it's the will of the people, I guess that's just democracy for ya.
These questions don't seem entirely relevant right now. It's not like some overarching existential threat really exists outside of some fringe movements, right? If a real threat was present, then we would obviously act. For example, some would argue that if they lived in the time of Nazi Germany, they wouldn't have been on the wrong side of history. They would do something. Such an obvious evil as the Nazis, however, benefits greatly from hindsight. This is represented in Arendt's banality of evil, the idea that evil can manifest in the most normal and even comical of appearances. Even Hitler, the man considered to be the very epitome of human evil, headed a largely incompetent administration, was reportedly quite lazy, obsessed with media and celebrity, was largely insecure of his lack of knowledge, leading to his habit of deliberately ignoring important information, and wasn't considered all that serious until, well, too late. As Tom Phillips writes, Hitler's personal failings didn't stop him having an uncanny instinct for political rhetoric that would gain mass appeal. And it turns out you don't actually need to have a particularly competent or functional government to do terrible things.
He keeps saying our government wasn't competent or functional. Then what is it? Did we kill those Jews or not?
This is a possible explanation for how seemingly incorruptible states get bad guys into power. Fringe individuals, apparently harmless with the ability to co-opt vacuums of justified rage for their own ideas of how the world should be, ideas that they might genuinely believe in, emerge from the shadows, and slowly as we ostracize such individuals, they band together in the shared pain of ridicule. We laugh and they continue to grow.
Aw, this guy's so cute and funny.
I grow in power.
Do you not see that he's growing in power? Look at him grow.
And one day, they inherit all of the biggest bombs, free to destroy a world that was never meant for them. Perhaps this is the greatest lesson, not yet finalized, regarding politics in 2020, that it is in imagining that there is some profound and radical dimension to human evil that needs to be pushed outside of our account of the normal society, that we miss the banality of its expansion. Laughing at the fungus does not help stop it. and there's nothing that fungus loves more than.
Hold up, they don't love you like I love you. Slow down, they don't love you like I love you. Back up, they don't love you like I love you. Step down, they don't love you like I love you.
The philosopher Harry Frankfurt years ago wrote a famous essay titled On Bullshit. His main summary of the bullshitter is as follows. Someone who lies and someone who tells the truth are playing on opposite sides, in the same game. Each responds to the facts as he understands them, although the response of the one is guided by the authority of the truth, while the response of the other defies the authority and refuses to meet its demands. The bullshitter ignores these demands altogether. He does not reject the authority of the truth, as the liar does, and oppose himself to it. He pays no attention to it at all. By virtue of this, bullshit is a greater enemy of the truth than lies are. Frankfurt then goes on to discuss the prevalence of BS, especially in the last few decades. He argues that BS is summoned whenever the obligation for one to speak surpasses one's own knowledge, as well as through the proliferation of anti-realism, or the skepticism which denies the ability to reliably access an objective reality, and thus any correct or universal truth. Frankfurt's words resonate strongly in 2020. A short journey through Reddit threads, Facebook posts, and Twitter feeds calls attention to the beginning of his essay. One of the most salient features of our culture is that there is so much bullshit, and despite our confidence in recognizing it, we are more often than not promoters and creators of it. Why? One meta-analysis at the University of Texas, a study that examined why people follow fake news, found that people will show a bias towards personal stories over scientific facts, especially in the case of medical emergencies. This might explain the instances of those in the "it's just a flu or I probably won't get it that bad" category, taking COVID seriously only after they or someone they love has suffered from the illness. They also found that individuals, when they perceive themselves under threat, will tend to dismiss empirical evidence and go with their gut feelings. The researchers cited the strange toilet paper shortage as a cause of this phenomena, where consumers who feel more vulnerable prefer subjective anecdotal information over statistical facts when making decisions. You'd think that threats to one's life or sense of normalcy would inspire a rigorous pursuit of the truth, right? This behavior reflects yet another important finding. People prefer to remain ignorant about information that would benefit them. For example, individuals will avoid learning information on their health, even if having such information would allow them to intervene and prevent further complications. One study even shows that only 7% of people at high risk for Huntington's disease will try to find out whether they actually have the condition. Overall, this large collection of findings points to the fact that deliberate ignorance is widely preferred. This, of course, isn't all bad. It's important to enjoy the present, and it's indisputably bad for your mental health to be in a constant state of neurotic analysis. For example, excessive use of social media for the latest health information on COVID is significantly related to depression and secondary trauma, sometimes known as compassion fatigue, in which one becomes traumatized through witnessing and exposing oneself to the suffering of others. The negative effects of this is likely evident in other forms of secondary trauma caused by doom scrolling, from constantly consuming information about public figures we dislike, to endlessly reading about the climate crisis. With that in mind, we should limit our exposure to bad news, to an extent, of course. In the same way that justified rage can be co-opted by bad guys and nefarious ideologies, so too can our seemingly innocent preference for ignorance be co-opted by bullshit. 2020 has been characterized, above all, by the mainstreaming of conspiracy theories. The rise of anti-vaxxers, 5Gers, climate skeptics, and QAnon all demonstrate bullshit at its peak. Programs that deliberately disregard the truth in order to change one's attitude. The events of this year only accelerate their rise. A study conducted in the University of Arizona demonstrates that when feelings of personal alienation or anxiety are combined with a sense that society is in jeopardy, people experience a kind of conspiratorial double whammy. This reflects the existential motives that stoke conspiratorial thinking, as one study points to our need to understand our environment, feel safe and in control, as well as maintain a positive image of the self and the social group one belongs to, as incentives to believe unbelievable and contradictory information. As an example, certain regions that depend on fossil fuels have demonstrated that the topic of climate change and energy transition is anything but an issue of policy. Rather, oil and gas may be tightly fixed to one's identity, evidence supporting the idea that fossil fuels are unsustainable, cause serious damage, and should be weaned off of, is then taken as an affront to one's identity. Hence, the development of certain contradictory views, such as the idea that there is actually very little scientific consensus regarding climate change, while, at the same time, framing oneself as a hero that is going against established consensus, emerges as a way to preserve existential security. Whatever form bullshit takes, conspiratorial or not, it's only further accelerated by the internet. In The Shallows, Carr makes the argument that writing has historically been undertaken with the idea that it will be received by a deep-thinking and attentive audience. Nowadays, however, the bidirectionality of the internet promotes an atmosphere of sociality, with every new piece of content being shared, liked, retweeted, and however else you found this video. Individuals now consume content for the feeling of belonging rather than personal enlightenment or amusement. As social concerns override literary ones, writers seem fated to eschew virtuosity and experimentation in favor of bland but immediately accessible style. Writing will become a means for recording chatter. The medium is the message, as McLuhan wrote, and in 2020, this message is also, more often than not, bullshit. Content creators need eye-catching titles to draw in eyeballs and appeal to the most primal of instincts, such as fear and sex, in order to keep us on. Companies pay big bucks in order to curate misleading ads for a sliver of your attention. Those with agendas merge half-truths with lies in order to shape social behavior. The inherent value of the content is, unfortunately, an afterthought.
Unfortunately?
In the abstract and noisy ocean of data, it makes sense as to why we would drift towards that which confirms our suspicions, satisfies our appetites, and comforts us. Who wants to live in a world that contradicts your worldview, that harbors others' views that can seemingly never coexist with your own? Are the only options an absolute embrace of moral relativism versus the retreat into the comfortable bubble of info consumption that confirms everything we wish to be true? Perhaps we should look inwards before anything else. When you catch yourself saying, "I don't believe," or "I believe," or "I feel," understand that your convictions are likely based on bullshit. Whether it's true or not, you hold on to it because it gives us a sense of self-identity. As the philosopher Michael Patrick Lynch argues, we all need convictions because we all need a self-identity. A picture of who we want to be. But when we make everything a matter of conviction, our self-identity expands in a dangerous way. We risk confusing our ego with truth, the shifting sands with real bedrock. As far back as 2009, Freedom House reports growing evidence of authoritarian regimes such as China, Russia, and Iran funding advanced techniques in order to spread misinformation through social media in other parts of the world, and evidently succeeding in their mission. Democratic backsliding, partially stoked by misinformation, has only increased since then. Likewise, bullshit, when embraced by a large number and propagated by those in power, can lead to real-life consequences. A recent study demonstrates that an embrace of conspiracy theories surrounding the pandemic is intimately linked with a lower tendency to adhere to advised health practices. Above all, these worrying trends that threaten the cozy idea that some agreed-upon truth is out there poses a series of world-changing existential threats, whether it be a potential death at the hands of the state through a respiratory illness, or through a decrease in air quality due to climate change. 2020 has truly been the year of...
alone, can't even open up my phone. The world is fucking terrible. I think I wanna be alone.
John Maynard Keynes famously said, "In the long run, we are all dead." Thanks to 2020, Keynes' quote is even further legitimized, forcing a world of short-term progress into an uncomfortable limbo. It's kind of weird to see so many threats to one's mortality at once, so many reminders that one day our breath will become air. For one, there's the slogan of "I can't breathe," the last words of several individuals who have died at the hands of law enforcement. The subsequent riots and protests that have used this saying emerge from the brute fact that African Americans are 2.5 times more likely to be killed by police officers than white men, as well as the fact that African Americans fatally shot by police are twice as likely as white people to be unarmed. The movement of Black Lives Matter, even when separated from the organization of the same name, has offended many. Especially through the strange mental gymnastics that saying one thing has value must also mean that other things do not have value. It also quite nicely challenges Baidu's notion of the emancipatory event. He notes that an occurrence such as the recording of George Floyd being choked to death isn't an event in itself until we see its eventual consequences. These consequences, a work of love by protesters, media figures, and college students that post a blank photo on their Instagram, demonstrate our fidelity to this occurrence, imbuing it with the status of an event. Usually the eventful sequence is fatigued and normal life returns. However, in this case, the protests, riots, and overall rage has failed to subsist, thanks largely to the persistence of the source of the rage. Even corporations have openly embraced a movement that also openly expresses Marxist leanings, demonstrating the mainstreaming of such an uncomfortable topic. Perhaps in the case of Floyd's death, the explicit image of one losing their breath was just enough for sustained outrage. There appears to be a growing awareness that fundamental qualities of our society, such as the idea that the police are a catch-all response to social problems, or that liberalism really is colorblind in its procedural form, were in fact illusions. Time will tell whether these institutions will adapt to such sustained criticism, or if they can be patient and wait for the movement to lose its momentum.
I think I'm gonna rent a Monte Carlo. Drive around the neighborhood like real slow. I love Lucy, I'm Ricky Ricardo. Hail Mary, meet me in the end zone.
Another breathtaking topic that has likely stoked the fires of outrage is COVID-19. The pandemic has brought forth a bizarre array of human behavior, including toilet paper hoarding, prejudice towards Asians, domestic violence, and suicide. Why is this? To a certain degree, the general population simply can't understand that science is a process rather than a list of eternal truths. Hence, conflicting information communicated by scientists at the beginning of a not yet understood event can leave individuals doubtful and skeptical of something that our whole world has actually depended on since the Enlightenment era, the scientific method. Equally, however, COVID is spooky. As Sheldon Solomon, the psychologist behind terror management theory, suggests, the pandemic reminds us of death, and this in turn amplifies both your good and bad core values. In short, humans struggle with the fact that our existence will be inevitably discontinued. To manage the terror that results in this, individuals adopt certain identities, beliefs, and values that give them a sense of purpose and symbolic continuation past their physical existence. Various studies show that thoughts of death will make people cling even more tightly to these beliefs, demonstrating that, for example, people will be more prejudiced towards other religions and will be more likely to support charismatic politicians. In the context of COVID, an era marked by daily death tolls and images of overcrowded hospitals, the persistent reminder of death results in those who are already skeptical of healthcare and authority figures to outright deny the threat and ignore recommendations. For these individuals, proper distancing and mask wearing appear as performative acts of mindless obedience and symbolize the decay of normalcy. Likewise, those with a more positive assessment of healthcare providers are more likely to act in a constructive way. And so is born a polarizing situation in which two groups see the other as an existential threat. Denial is natural. Motivated reasoning, the behavior that allows us to dismiss facts that fail to fit into our worldview, is far more a product of human nature than plain ignorance. It is simply far more existentially comfortable to deny a seemingly hopeless and destructive fact than to rework your identity and worldview. In the same way that physics has the principle of least action, so too does our limited cognitive capacities operate on the principle of least mental effort. And so nothing happens, and the thing we deny grows and grows until it's at our doorstep. Which reminds me of something else.
We've got 5 years stuck on my eyes. 5 years, what a surprise. We've got 5 years, my brain hurts a lot. 5 years, that's all we got.
This is a book about man's war against nature, and because man is part of nature, it is also inevitably a book about man's war against himself, begins Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, a desperate plea all the way back in 1962 for leaders to recognize human impact on the environment. Climate change, much like the current pandemic, is yet another global disaster intimately tied to human behavior and largely catalyzed by dogma, denialism, and inaction. In spite of its apocalyptic potentials, we nonetheless continue to act as if we will be unscathed by its consequences. George Orwell, discussing the radical leftists of his age, offers a critique that one can apply to mainstream environmentalism. We all rail against class distinctions, but very few people seriously want to abolish them. Here, you come upon the important fact that every revolutionary opinion draws parts of its strength from a secret conviction that nothing can be changed. In other words, the possibility of change is evoked to guarantee that it will not be acted upon. I mean, who is really willing to sacrifice their lifestyle for the small likelihood that the next generation won't go full WALL-E? I mean, is it really that big of an issue? Let's quickly run through some basic facts. Is it happening? Yes. General consensus for evidence of human-made climate change bounces between 90% and 100%. Expertise in climate science is strongly correlated with consensus. Is it a natural part of the Earth's cooling and warming process? According to recent research by Scientific Data, the current warming period has actually reversed a 6,500-year-old natural cooling trend. The argument that humans are only minimally enhancing ecological collapse will unfortunately have to find another potential explanation for rising temperatures if it wants to claim that the link between rising carbon emissions and climate change is coincidental. Why should we be worried? There's many reasons, but here's one that's already happening. Using data already available from rising heatwave deaths in the past decade, one study by PLOS Medicine has suggested that heatwave deaths will skyrocket if we do little between now and 2080. But aren't these scientists just producing manipulated data for ideological or financial reasons? This would mean that not only a large and diverse group of scientific journals have come together to fudge the facts, but would also presume that various oil companies, such as Shell and significantly ExxonMobil, are in on it. Exxon even participated in climate research in the 1970s and 80s that led to an internal report concluding that the consequences of climate change as a result of fossil fuels would be catastrophic, to which this report was then hidden until the company was accused in 2016 of knowing about rising carbon emissions and nonetheless running misinformation campaigns. Okay, well, aren't the solutions too expensive and unrealistic? The cost of natural disasters linked to climate change has quadrupled since 1980, bringing us to a total amount of $1.77 trillion. 55% of global GDP depends on high-functioning biodiversity. The cost will more than likely rise exponentially. Some possible solutions, such as putting a revenue-neutral price on pollution, is projected to largely help out the economy. This view is backed by a large number of economists, ranging from 27 Nobel Prize laureates to two former secretaries of the US Department of Treasury. But as the most perceptive of viewers might point out, me telling you to get rid of fossil fuels and plastics is hypocritical. How did you charge your laptop to make this video? Certainly you've used air travel and plastic utensils. Why should you listen to a hypocrite? A great example of this argument is from the Canadian politician Jason Kenney, who, when asked about Greta Thunberg's visit to Alberta, wondered aloud how her supporters charged their iPhones. This is called a non sequitur, a conclusion that doesn't follow logically from the main argument. By using an ad hominem remark, the respondent directs the attention away from the valid argument and personally denigrates the image of the arguer. As the Harvard historian Naomi Oresk argues, the fact that abolitionists wore clothes created through slavery does not lead us to conclude that slavery is to not be abolished. Nor does the fact that Mandela criticized politicians, and was a politician, suggest that apartheid should have continued. Yes, these individuals were part of a system they advocated against, but they understood that simply not wearing clothes made by slaves or not participating in politics was the solution. They recognized that these issues were structurally powerful and the very backbone of their society. Fossil fuels are right now the backbone of our society, and any individual would have to entirely disengage from this society they are attempting to change in order to avoid hypocrisy. Another issue raised by recent opinion pieces is that renewables aren't actually all that renewable. Planet of the Humans, a documentary that presents green energy as imperfect and problematic, is just one example. This argument, as one critic of the film puts it, is akin to arguing that because fruit contains sugar, eating strawberries is no healthier than eating a cheesecake. Let's not let perfect be the enemy of the good. And no, we are not nearly on track to do anything about this. For many, the decision to have kids will be weighed with the fact that the world will soon face exponentially worse natural disasters, resource conflict, mass migration, polluted air, and the potential release of deadly pathogens through melting permafrost. And that's barely mentioning the existential threat of AI, democratic backsliding, the wave of mental health issues, growing inequality, hunger, poaching. It really looks like there's very few checks on the president's ability to launch a nuclear missile.
I'm glad to see about how climate change is going to cause positive feedback loops from the permafrost. Have you ever feel the vibe that societally we've kind of given up on trying to solve climate change, and now we're all just collectively plugged in? Damn, you ever think about what the future might be? Damn, you ever look at the amount of terrible land that they're moving for 30 years? Not as much as there is now. Stop adjusting the doomsday clock to be like 10% closer to midnight and just put it on midnight already.
Stories I could tell you. We are fucked, and until we recognize that we are fucked, we will remain so. Whether or not truth is well true appears to matter little for many. Instead, a great deal of humanity, however unintentionally, has settled for existential security, for a comprehensible reality, a reason to merely exist. And who can blame us? Reality is not defined by simplicity, but rather complexity. We need to at least feel like we know what's going on and who we are. Simple explanations are widely valued, and rightly so. They better yield knowledge and facilitate control of our world. But this is not because simple explanations are more likely to be true. Rather, perhaps surprisingly, it is in part due to the ways in which they are false. We are constrained by our very cognition. Humans can't register everything going on around us, so we invent symbols, values, and language to manage and find purpose in our time spent here. And try as we might, our efforts to see the world as it is only further reflects Nietzsche's statement that man is something between an ape and God. We only become further confused, drifting from view to view, identity to identity. What is the truth and who is right? Are we fucked and there's no turning back? Cue hopelessness. The philosopher Slavoj Žižek argues that it takes courage to feel hopeless. It is only when we despair and don't know anymore what to do that change can be enacted. We have to go through this zero point of hopelessness. He notes that these days, even the most cynical of analyses conclude with a refreshing hint of salvation, a proverbial light at the end of the tunnel. He states that true courage is not to imagine an alternative, but to accept the consequences of the fact that there is no clearly discernible alternative. Žižek sees these alternatives, democracy, religion, liberalism, capitalism, communism, as fetishes that block us from thinking to the end of the deadlock of our predicament. He argues that this light at the end of the tunnel is more often than not the headlight of another train coming to hit us. That's encouraging. Like the stages of grief, many of us are in a state of bargaining. We've attempted to regain control of the absurdity of our conditions through standing for something, whatever that may be. What Žižek advises is a necessary next step, a journey through depression and finally acceptance, to make peace with the chaos of the world. And then what? Do we let history just take place? I guess what I've made here, to some extent, exists to instill this sense of hopelessness. But I do think hopelessness is strangely a good motivational force. Almost as if, when confronted by absolute hopelessness, we hope for something to hope for. I guess this is how new values and new ways of thinking about the world form. The collision between this absolute abandonment of previous systems and beliefs with an urgent craving for something to hope for frees us from past ideals and values, and in doing so, asks us what we are free for. Absolute hopelessness begets a creative spirit that can offer unheard of solutions for our unimaginable times. Albert Camus, in a speech titled The Human Crisis, writes passionately about the resistance generation of France, a generation that experienced nothing short of absolute hopelessness. 25 years of international politics had taught us to question any notion of purity and to conclude that no one was ever wrong because everyone might be right. The modern crisis is inevitable because no one in the West can be sure of their immediate future, and all live with the more or less defined fear that they will be crushed to bits, one way or another, by history. Those in the resistance saw a world around them devoid of truth and hope. Nonetheless, the heroes did their best to negate this idea that we are simply passengers of history. Camus takes them as examples to criticize the Hegelian idea that history makes man. Instead, man makes history. This is something we should never forget. We can't pretend to escape history, for we are in history. You are actively making history. Whatever you choose to do or not do each day is an act of historical significance. You don't have to accept the way things are, and nobody will fix these things until we take responsibility for our world. Now, consuming every piece of bad news while doing nothing, under the guise that you must stay informed, makes you no better than a masochistic spectator. And ignoring all bad news isn't any better. Ignorance may be bliss, but it is also a privilege. Those in terrible circumstances rarely have the means to take a day of self-care or practice minimalism. If all we have is each other, we should look out for one another when we have the strength to do so. Decency starts here. And understand that you are an idiot, and I am an idiot. And just in general, lower your expectations for human beings. The world today exists because of a disregard for collective humility. Each side, scared to live in uncertainty, casts out some mistruth, hoping that the volume of their lie will occlude the dark fact that we don't really know why we're here or what's actually true. And yes, accept that there may be no absolute truth, but also understand that there are certain realities that you and those you love would prefer over others. Fight for those. With that being said, take action. Get involved. None of the issues mentioned so far are written in stone. Of course, you don't need to save the world, you don't even need to save your neighborhood. I get it. You have to work, take care of your family, and take care of your mental health. But none of these are excuses for an absolute renunciation of involvement. As Edmund Burke wrote, Nobody made a greater mistake than he who did nothing because he could only do a little. If there is something that fills you with despair, find the means to limit it in some capacity. Still, remain wary of fatalistic narratives, simplified explanations, and your own preference towards ignorance. Your very justified rage is still susceptible to great evils. Likewise, remain vigilant and skeptical, but face the fact that this very skepticism may just as well be a mechanism of your own ignorance rather than a badge of nuance. The actions you take will have unintended consequences, and ignorance will only enhance this. Perhaps these issues can be prevented through focusing on what's in front of us first and foremost, through the little steps, by focusing less on utopian end results and more on what can be done now. We are less likely to use the ends to justify questionable means. You are your own hope. Before you decry humanity as a parasitic cancer, note that you yourself belong to this group. If you have the capacity to do good, then all is not lost. Those who state that they hate humanity or defer the responsibility of the present to future generations simply feed their own cynicism. And I think we've had enough of that. We are our own hope. For ourselves and for better or worse, we are all there is. Except that all is lost up until the point that you are still here, breathing, with the capacity to do something. Vote if you can, educate, protest, reform. You exist within a potential space for which history is still to be written.
Or a supergirl in a thankless world these days.
On this channel with my good friend Syphilis69. Sorry about the monetization status of this video after including me in it, buddy.